not look like I am. So we're going to have to fix that because it doesn't look like I am coming in at all. Anybody hear me okay? Hold on. What a terrible time to have. Oh.
Let's try that again. Happy third. There we go. Now we are coming in, hopefully, loud and clear. Happy Thursday, everybody. Welcome to a couple of Chair League games we have to cast tonight. First one is a Division III Chair League game. It is Feral Clan versus House of Chez. Both teams currently sitting at 1-2. Feral Clan is a new team to Chair League. This is their first season. House of Chez is a veteran Chair League team, having participated in all four seasons. Have been as high as Division II, but for the last two seasons have been in Division III. They typically are hovering right around the 500 mark, and this season no exception at the aforementioned 1-2 record. So one of these teams will break into the 500 mark, and the other one will fall to 1-3 after our game, which is scheduled to start here in about 2 minutes. The away team, House of Chez, has decided to play on Cursed Hollow, and that means Feral Clan will be banning first and using the first overall pick as well. Just waiting for one more person from House of Chez to... Oh, there he is. So we just got our last member. Just waiting for all members to sign in on the Chair League site. And there we go. So we will be officially starting up momentarily. And that's good timing for all involved. Our second game tonight will be a Division II game. And both of those teams are at 3-0, so both teams fighting to stay at the top of Division II. All right, we have officially started the draft here. So Feral Clan on the clock for their first ban. Lately we've been seeing Ragnaros, of course, first ban worthy. Murky dominating Hero League. However, not so much in Organized are we seeing him. There's the Ragnaros ban I was referring to. Artana, certainly a possibility. Malph, still really solid. Lucio still out there as well. A number of heroes that could be banned here for House of Chez. Dahaka is also an organized play, is very highly contested. And you can see right now House of Chez is kind of debating between the Malph and the Dahaka bans. And currently looks like they're favoring Malfurion. Malfurion's roots on Cursed Hollow is particularly good because of all the narrow corridors. All those narrow corridors are just about the size of that lawn that Malfurion grows to root his enemies. So not a bad ban at all for House of Chez. Feral Clan wasting no time and first picking Vala. She is certainly one of the top assassins in Heroes of the Storm. both in the more solo type environment that we're used to and in organized play as well. She gets even more effective when you can pair her with some kind of a support to babysit her, like a Tassadar or a Zarya shield generated, or really allows the Vala player to go ham and put more pressure on the opposing team. Quick response from House of Chez, ETC selected one of the top two or three tanks in Heroes, as well as Falstad. His global is a big factor, as well as the Just, arguably the most impactful heroic ability in Heroes of the Storm. And this draft is just flying along. Feral Clan taking the double support that I was referring to, Tassadar shields to babysit Vala, and I would assume with the composition that's built around Vala, I would not be at all surprised to get Bloodlust Rhaegar. That leaves House of Chez to select their next ban, their mid-draft ban, and looks like they're deciding on possibly Artanis. Would make a lot of sense, as Feral Clan hasn't selected a warrior yet, and Artanis can be very frustrating to play against sometimes, no matter how close he seems to dying. Those shields just seem to keep proccing, and he does not go down. Now maybe favoring the Diablo. Really, obviously, it's going to be a warrior ban here. Diablo is another one of those warriors that's really in the meta right now. The warrior meta in particular has just a lot of viable options, and this battlefield, Cursed Hollow, has a lot of walls to slam people into. Maybe that's what they were thinking with the Diablo ban. Feral Clan coming back with the Anubarak. I'm a little surprised they didn't try to further choke out the support, as House of Chez has already selected one warrior, and with Malph banned and Rhaegar and Tassadar selected, they could have choked out that support class even more. But maybe they have a mage in mind, and they want to keep Anubarak off the board. He is very good at soaking up mage damage with his spell shield at one. House of Chez now has two selections to make. I would imagine we will see at least one range damage. It'll be interesting to see if they decide to leave their fifth pick as a flex pick, or if they leave the support, and they don't. So they are leaving their fifth pick as a flex pick, giving them the flexibility to respond to whatever Feral Clan goes with, selecting Nazebo, who has very good damage and a ton of wave clear and Brightwing. And we have a Cho'Gall sighting, ladies and gentlemen. Feral Clan snap picking the Cho'Gall. That would certainly explain the Anubarak ban because of the cocoon. They do have a Brightwing response on the other side. However, that's really the only counter that they currently have. So I would certainly expect to see Tychus, Raynor, maybe a Leoric, something with a percentage-based damage to chunk down that Cho'Gall. And those are the heroes that I mentioned that do that. So I imagine this pick will go right down to the wire, because usually Cho'Gall is an unexpected curveball that they throw, and I'm sure House of Chez is deciding what they want to go with. Cho'Gall is not somebody you see on Cursed Hollow usually. He's typically chosen on more two-lane maps, where the lack of body is less of an issue than on the three-lane maps. They do go with Raynor. That will be for the giant killer that Raynor gets and the consistent auto-attack poke damage. Now is the hero swapping round. Looks like everybody is on the heroes that they want, and we will be loading into Cursed Hollow momentarily. So the blue team, all sporting their plebe knight portraits, is Feral Clan. Blue Cobalt will be on Tassadar, Commodus will be on Gaul, Basic Feral on Cho, and they will combine to make Basecom. Rhaegar will be played by Chrono's Blade, and Vala will be played by Skate. Playing the part of our red team this evening, we have House of Chez, with Flash on Nazebo, Chezmix on ETC, Caribou on Brightwing, Deathocaris on Raynor, and Mariner 005, or maybe Mariner 005, on Falstaff. It will be interesting to see the lane assignments that Feral Clan goes with. One of the things you have to consider when you have a Cho'Gall on your team is you have one less body. So that can limit your lane assignments here a little bit. I imagine we'll have Tassadar soloing one of the lanes, and I'm not sure who will take the other one. It'll be interesting to see how they make that decision.
Fight.
Of course, House of Chez has the advantage of double globals here on Cursed Hollow. Both teams moving forward, ready to take the traditional 5-on-5 mid lane skirmish. Currently, though, lots of dancing, no violence, no gunfire, no magic flying through the air, and none will happen until these minions crash on each other. Cho'Gall looks like he will be moving to the top lane. Rhaegar and Vala moving to the bottom, leaving poor old Tassadar to deal with the entirety of House of Chez still in the mid lane. Looks like three members will rotate north to deal with Cho'Gall, who is a little bit far forward. With ETC CC, they may be in trouble here. And there's the power slide, there's the zombie wall, and Raynor is wailing on him. Toads and spiders and zombies, machine guns and axes shaped like guitars will allow Cho'Gall to barely escape with less than 10 hit points. So that was a really nice rotation by House of Chez, and they were one auto attack away from leaving Cho'Gall as the first blood of the game. In the meantime, in the mid lane, we have the completely uneventful and boring one-on-one battle of two supports as Brightwing and Tassadar square off. In the bottom lane, Falstad will certainly be forced to soak safely from within his towers with Vala and Rhaegar down here. We will return to the top lane where all eyes are on Cho'Gall and the three members of House of Chez opposing him. So in the top lane, House of Chez will certainly win this lane. You are correct, Troy. I did have that wrong. Top lane will be won by House of Chez, while bottom lane will be won by Feral Clan, and the mid lane will be a boring stalemate. Cho'Gall does venture out of his own gate, only to be power slid by ETC and forced back to under his fourth command. So this front wall on the verge of collapsing. In the bottom lane, though, Falstad doing a little bit better of a job of defending. So it looks like House of Chez is getting the slight advantage of the trade. However, neither team able to take advantage of the Merc camps to put split pressure during the tribute. It looks like ETC is going to try to slow the rotation by Cho'Gall. Nice job by Chezmix of slowing him down. The tribute has popped. Brightwing in a tough spot there. Caribou needs to be very careful. That was a dangerous rotation here. And Vala has started the channel. It's going to be close. Rhaegar going out to zone. Chezmix dives in for a face melt to interrupt the tribute. Vala does get caught in the zombie wall. Raynor is low on life and putting all of his damage into Cho'Gall. That is his job, of course. Rhaegar out in front. He is low. Falstaff finally able to join the fray. Flies in, throws out lightning bolts and electric hammers. Feral Clan forced to retreat, but nobody has been able to secure the tribute just yet. Both teams have caps. Chezmix dives in, tries to isolate out the Rhaegar. Tassadar shields, though, are on the spot, and now Chezmix needs to go and give Brightwing a hug to get those heals. It looks like the red health bars here are a little bit lower. The poke from Vala and Cho'Gall, as well as the double support, giving Feral Clan the advantage in this drawn-out battle. Chezmix has no mana, as does Flash. I think they have to call off the dogs here and surrender this tribute very, very soon. And it looks like that's what they're doing. So House of Chez deciding to simply withdraw and surrender the tribute rather than lose any lives for the battle. And that was a smart decision, I think. They were getting very low on health and mana. Feral Clan able to secure the first tribute of the game, but House of Chez able to rotate two lanes quicker. Maybe they will get a small XP soak advantage here. Vala and Rhaegar resuming their assault on the bottom lane. Falstad is doing what he can, but that is not going to be much. This fort bottom here will eventually fall unless House of Chez gives Falstad some reinforcements. However, the same can be said of True No, because this time House of Chez has Nazebo on the Giants, and they hope for a top tribute that will allow those Giants to get some value in the bottom lane. Any minute now, that second tribute will pop here, and the first one is always neutral, and the second one will be on one of the two sides of the map, giving one of the two teams an advantage. That's a lot of damage by Raynor. If he does pop, though, he is taking a ton of poke from Cho'Gall, and he's going to have to hurt back, and that's unfortunate timing. Once again, I think House of Chez, with the positioning of this second tribute on Feral Clan side of the map, and Rhaegar and ETC both hearthing back, it looks like House of Chez will concede the second tribute as well. This has been a very close game, but so far the double support into the Cho'Gall paying off in that long protracted team battle has allowed Feral Clan to secure both tributes 1 and 2, leaving them only one tribute away from the first curse of the game. However, both tributes have popped on bottom. The third tribute will definitely pop right here on House of Chez's side of the map in the top lane. Raynor and ETC resuming their battle with Cho'Gall. Raynor a little too far forward. ETC tanking power shots. They do trade Raynor for a fountain. Brightwing was a little bit late on the teleport. She would have arrived just in the nick of time to save Raynor had she been there 2 seconds earlier. Feral Clan on the verge of their heroic abilities, and that would be terrible timing for House of Chez and would almost force them to concede the first curse. And unless they get that heroic abilities as well, they will not be able to contest this third tribute. We have Reign of Vengeance for Vala, no surprise, Bloodlust for Rhaegar, Hammer of Twilight for Cho, Shadowbolt Volley for Gaul, and Archon for Tassadar. They're trying desperately, House of Chez is, to get their level 10s. They're very close, and they do. However, Cho'Gall has invaded top. Nice power slide by Chez on ETC. Now both teams are posturing on the tribute, and we will indeed have a fight for it. Tassadar does get caught in the zombie wall and stays side out. However, his E was up, and he took no damage. The wombo combo, however, from House of Chez gives them their first team fight victory of the game. Vala, the only member of Feral Clan to survive the massacre, and she does so with less than 100 hit points. House of Chez has turned this game on his head with their perfect timing of their ultimates and the decisive call to turn on the boss, and they had Mercs pushing in the mid lane that whole time. So this map is really currently dancing to the tune that House of Chez is playing. Tribute will pop soon. It could really go anywhere. It looks like Feral Clan is trying to get their own boss. However, that is late, and they are going now have to fight over the boss while House of Chez's boss pushes uncontested in the top lane. It looks like we will have another 5-on-5 here. Feral Clan, though, will have a aggroed boss in its back. ETC takes a lot of damage. There goes the Bloodlust. Cho'Gall is absolutely isolated by the zombie wall and melted, and House of Chez will take their second boss. While three members of Feral Clan are taken out in Tassadar and Cho'Gall, what a turn of events here. Feral Clan in a lot of trouble. Two bosses pushing. They've lost their bruisers. They've lost the last two tributes. And House of Chez really in a great position here. Let's see what they choose to do here. It looks like Nazebo is going to go back, fill up on mana, and the rest of the team will rotate to put pressure on this mid lane. While the two teams were fighting over the bottom boss, the top boss completely destroyed Pharaoh Clan's top lane fort. Mid fort here under pressure from the four members of House of Chez. Bottom fort under pressure from the boss. And it looks like two forts will be destroyed by House of Chez before they have even secured the first curse of the game. However, Chez Mix may be caught in an ambush here. He does power slide away from trouble. Without Vala in the neighborhood, though, and without their 13, this is certainly not a battle that Pharaoh Clan wants to take. House of Chez deciding to rotate, and they will try to eliminate these last and final first level force of Pharaoh Clan. However, that rotation has put them at a disadvantage as the tribute has spawned in the top lane. Pharaoh Clan is already here, however, they are two levels behind. Falstad has flown in to try to stall this out. However, he will only be able to do it for so long. He ate a full Shadow Bolt volley. The gust completely missed. ETC stage diving on the back line. The globals for House of Chez coming into play right here. There goes Hyperion. It's a little far back and only now arriving on the battlefield. Vala and Falstad are the first members to go. A one for one. Brightwing is in trouble, and there he goes. Cho'Gall doing a ton of damage, but he's very low, and the zombie wall takes down Cho'Gall. Two members left for each team, ETC and Nazebo fighting. However, both supports unable to secure it. Blue Cobalt forced to retreat, and that was a regular bloodbath for the fifth tribute of the game. I haven't had a chance to really go over Heroes of Chez heroics here, and we will do so now. Ravenous Spirit for Nazebo, Stage Dive as we saw for ETC, Blink Heal for Brightwing, Hyperion for Raynor, and Mighty Gust for Falstad. Pharaoh Clan is on the back foot here. They are two levels down. They have the curse pushing in all three of their lanes with pressure on all of their keep walls. However, so many members of House of Chez died, they're just now spawning and moving onto the battlefield that they haven't been able to capitalize on this curse quite yet. It looks like they're going to choose to do mercs and continue their strategy of controlling this map, painting everything red, and forcing Pharaoh Clan to respond to more and more pressure throughout the map. Cho'Gall also is one of those heroes that struggles as he falls further and further behind in level, and that will make it even more difficult for Pharaoh Clan here, especially now that Raynor has picked up Giant Killer. They're really going to chunk out Cho'Gall in these team fights. House of Chez moving as a team into the top lane. Not too much structure damage there from that first curse. However, you can see on the minimap, all the lanes are freshed out. And as Pharaoh Clan has revealed themselves in the other lane, a great decision by House of Chez to take the top merc camp. All of the mercs are red, and they are pushing in hard on the top lane. This top tower is already nearly dead. Great zoning zombie wall by Flash on the depot. He has really been spot on with his heroics, and now the top wall for this keep has been destroyed. Shadow Bolt Volley has been popped, however, not much value out of it as House of Chez was already choosing to disengage, and they are going to take their level 16 Talonteer advantage and go right for the boss one more time. You have to wonder if Pharaoh Clan has sniffed this out, and they are moving in this direction. ETC is out there to zone. It's going to be close. I think they will have this burned down right as Pharaoh Clan gets here. However, with Gust, they will be able to secure it. That was almost very sneaky of Blue Cobalt. Feed in, however, wasn't able to get there. Tassadar goes down. Cho'Gall goes down. Rhaegar goes down. An absolute rout in favor of House of Chez. Vala is running for her life. lightning striking down on her from Falstad, and he is able to secure the kill. Disaster for Feral Clan as the full might of House of Chez is barreling down this top lane toward their exposed keep, and they are supported by a 2-level advantage and a boss. So this keep was not long for this world. I think it's a little early for a core call, and House of Chez agrees with me. They are rotating away from this top lane. Falstad flying toward the tribute. I assume the rest of House of Chez will try to push in this mid lane and really keep the pressure on Feral Clan. Now they are getting even more aggressive with the second boss call, with Feral Clan pent up in their own base defending. There's not a lot the Feral Clan can do to defend this. And the fourth boss of this game will be secured by House of Chez. They are in the driver's seat. This is definitely their game to lose. Feral Clan really needs a team fight for a victory here, and they need one bad if they're ever to do it, and they want to do it before House of Chez gets to 20 while both teams are on the same talent here. So unfortunately, this is probably the best fight that they're going to get, despite the fact that this boss is barreling down on. The bottom outer defenses for this keep were destroyed very, very quickly. Boss already wailing on the keep. Hyperion goes out to provide support, and there goes Stage Dive and Ravenous Spirit on the back line. Cho'Gall really getting chunked down by Raynor. A peeling Rain of Vengeance make that two peeling Rain of Vengeance will allow her teammates to get out alive safely. However, that is now two keeps that have been destroyed by House of Chez. The tribute popping. No, absolutely no mercy here by House of Chez. They are keeping all the pressure on, capturing this hard camp while Falstad flies to the tribute. If Feral Clan sniffs this out, it's an opportunity for them. However, they didn't realize their opponent was there, and they were not able to ambush them. House of Chez moving around the map, taking all of the mercenaries. Feral Clan here is in a very rough situation. Cho'Gall forced to go back and destroy catapults before they do more damage. You can see the shield on the core is down, so they really need to prioritize those catapults until those shields respond. Meanwhile, House of Chez completely dominating in the map control department. Feral Clan just has not been able to recover from that defeat that they suffered right as both teams reached level 10. Not a lot to do right here for House of Chez. They have reached level 20. It looks like they will be content to wait for the next tribute, and they are. They're moving in force to the tribute spawn. Full health, full mana for all members. ETC, played by Chezmix, in position to intercept his opponent, and he does. Cho'Gall making contact with ETC. ETC taking a nice chunk of damage. There's the zoning zombie wall. Cho'Gall forced to pop his stasis and not take any additional damage. There's Hyperion, the stage dive on the back line. However, the wind tunnel completely zones away Feral Clan. Cho'Gall goes down again, and this, ladies and gentlemen, could be the opportunity that House of Chez needed to win this game. With Curse and Cho'Gall down, all five members are now pushing in with Giants. Falstad intercepts Rhaegar on the backside and sends him back to the Altar of Storms, as does Vala, and this will most certainly be game. Congratulations to House of Chez for taking the win here, able to deal with the Cho'Gall curveball that Feral Clan threw them, and secures their victory, increasing their record to 2-2. And right on time, actually we're about 10 minutes ahead of time for our game two. So congratulations to House of Chez. They really controlled that game from about halfway through there. Flash on Nazebo in particular, I thought was very impressive with the positioning of his zombie walls. Him and ETC worked in really good tandem to isolate out Cho'Gall in particular, and he also used it for a number of different zoning opportunities to control how those engagements went. So good game for the veteran House of Chez team, evening their record in Division 3 at 2-2. Our second game will be a Division 2 game versus two undefeated Division 2 teams. Yeah, I said that too, the same thing. You don't see Cho'Gall as much on the bigger three-lane maps. Usually you'll see him on the smaller two-lane maps or Tomb. But his lack of lane presence makes it a little harder to pull off on those large three-lane maps. So we're about 10 minutes from our next game, which is scheduled to start here at 6 o'clock. So we have a little bit of time to kill. Lion Speed, one of the two teams we will be seeing here in our second game of the day, is another veteran Cheer League team. They've been around since Season 2. Excuse me, I just have the very tail end of a cold here I'm dealing with. Lion Speed, been around since Season 2. In Season 2, in Division 2, they went 6-6. And last season in Division 2, they went 3-5. But Season 4, they've really been a team on fire. One of the, I believe, four undefeated teams still in Division 2 at 3-0. So with a win here, they could be one of the top two teams in Division 2. And their opponent, Giant Killer, in the same boat. Giant Killer, this is their second season here in Cheer League. Last season in Division 3, they played very well. They went 4-1 and opted to promote themselves up to Division 2, and certainly have no regrets also at 3-0. So I would imagine we're going to have a very nice game here to start. If you're not familiar with Cheer League, I would be surprised, one, because you're here. But check it out at cheerleague.com. It's a ton of fun. Recreational Heroes of the Storm play. I play in it. I've played in Cheer League since Season 1. I've been casting at since Season 2. And it's just a playing Heroes of the Storm in a five-man team on comms, it is a really different experience than playing in a solo, like Hero League, what most of us play as. It's just more fun. You can be more creative with your comps when you're kind of solo Hero League with randos. It's more limiting to what you can do with regards to the comp because the communication is limited. You have to do usually more straightforward type stuff. But when you get a five-man on comms, especially with people who you've developed familiarity with, who you have some amount of cohesion with as teammates in the game, it allows you to be more creative, pull off more complex things, maybe think outside of the box and do just strategies and comps you can't do in solo league. And that's one of the fun things about Cheer League is that you can do that. And it's a great community. My friends list has probably doubled since my involvement in Cheer League. I've met so many really great people from within the Cheer League community. So highly encourage you to check it out if you haven't done so yet. Right now we had our first member of either of these teams popped up in the game and... Or pop up in the game lobby here. And it looks like his whole team is there. Let me see if we can figure out which team this is, because then I can figure out. Oh, good. So it is the away team, which means we can maybe get our map selection. Last season, Jova, the creator, CEO, founder, guru of Chair League, switched the games from played every 30-minute blocks to 20-minute blocks, which was fantastic from casters, because 30 minutes between games was really tight to schedule back-to-back games, so that forced you to either run late the second game or play games an hour apart. But the 20-minute blocks allows you to schedule teams 40 games 40 minutes apart, which is perfect, because even when we had a pretty quick game like that, there's really not too much downtime between sets, and it's very rare that you're running late. So we have our second map of the game, of the evening, I should say, will be on Sky Temple. I don't think I've had a chance to cast Sky Temple this Chair League season. So it should be a lot of fun. Sky Temple is one of the larger Chair League, Heroes of the Storm map. I think it's the second largest behind Warhead Junction. So Global's certainly highly, highly valued. As well as heroes that can hold those temples as they spawn to shoot at the opposition structures. So we do have the first team here. second team, I imagine, will be joining us here any minute now. Because we are about 5 minutes from game time. So Giant Killer is here, and they are jumping into lobby. And we are just waiting for Lion Speed. And maybe they are here. There's more people in the lobby now. Oh, just kidding. So Sky Temple, if you're not familiar, has three temples on the map that will activate at various points in the game. And whichever team holds that temple will channel shots on the opposition structures, and those temples, in addition to likely being defended by your opponents, will also be defended by automated little temple guardian guys that spawn. The first time those temples spawn is always going to be middle and top, and the second one will always be bottom only. So it behooves teams to time the merc camps accordingly. Specifically on the second merc camp, you want to make sure you have pressure in the top lane with the bruisers. And if you can take out the opponent's fountain in the bottom lane before that second temple phase happens, it really puts your team at an advantage. And I frequently find whichever team does better in the second temple phase tends to win the game, simply because they set themselves up so much in the early game. Always exceptions to the rule, of course. But that second temple phase in particular is very important. Very important. This map also sports maybe the most classic throw pit in any of the Heroes battlefields. All the times you see on those Heroes WTF moments or various videos that pop up on Reddit, that has a boss throw pit. This one is one of the ones you'll see a lot. You'll even see it happen in the pros sometimes, and that's why it's called a throw pit. So still waiting for Lion Speed. Would imagine they will be joining us here any minute, as we are 2 minutes from official game time. I think we will have a game, because Lion Speed does have a number of members signed into Chair League, which is usually a good sign. So, Giant Killer and I just chilling out here in the game lobby, waiting for Lion Speed to make an appearance here. Sorry about that, Chan. I will try to up that a little bit. I appreciate you letting me know as well. Hopefully that will come in a little bit better. Sometimes I have a nice mic up here. However, when my little one is in the background, that mic picks up everything, including her, and I think it's distracting. So when she's around, I tend to go with the headset. It doesn't pick up me quite as well, but there won't be nearly as much background noise going on as if I use the mic. If any of you have little children at home, they can be very loud. And my little daughter is no exception. I hit a small milestone for myself today, since we have a little time to kill. Still coming in soft, huh? That's a bummer. All right, let me try something. Let me know if that's any better, guys. I turned it all the way up. So hopefully there is a delay on the stream. So by the time you guys hear me saying this, it should be better. But please let me know. Well, we are officially at game time, still waiting for our second team. Hopefully they will show momentarily. There is a 10-minute grace period. I hope they arrive here very soon. I really want to catch the second game. And I would hate to have a Giant Killer here show up for a game and not have one. So I started to say I hit a small milestone for myself today. I got my 100th Twitch follower, which not that big a deal, but still pretty cool. So for those of you that are here supporting me, what I do in my spare time, my very, very small contribution to our Heroes community, I do appreciate it. I would really hate to see a forfeit here, especially with two undefeated teams who are, you know, posturing themselves for our Division II playoffs here. Chair League does have playoffs at the end of the season. And assuming it's done like it was last season, 16 teams from each of the four divisions will make it in to the playoffs. I assume that'll be the case this year as well, although he has not officially announced. Hey, we just got somebody. So let's see if that's our second team. And I hope it is. All right. So he said they're running a couple minutes late, but they will be on in a second. So we will have a second game here. That is exciting. Expecting a really good game here against teams that should be pretty evenly matched. So, any minute now. Just waiting for the last four. In the meantime, I can officially press the start button on chairleague.com. Perfect. Great. All right. Well, as far as Chairleague goes, we are officially underway. Just waiting for the last couple members of Lion Speed, and we should have a fantastic game to watch. Very excited. Oh, excuse me, one more time. I said I'm fighting off the back end of a cold, so every now and then I got to hit that cough button and mute it so I don't blast you guys with it. That's no fun. All right, second member of Lion Speed coming in, and I imagine the next three will be joining them shortly because a 2-on-5 would not be a fair fight. This should be starting any minute now. Just letting each team to decide who they want to be their designated drafter. And waiting for the last members of Lion Speed to jump in here. And I will be hitting that draft button hopefully within the next 60 seconds or so. Got to see a Cho'Gall in that first game. I would be very surprised if we get to see another Cho'Gall. That's always a surprise. When we see Cho'Gall. Two members we're waiting for from Lion Speed. I imagine we're going to see Falstad this game. Dehaka, Brightwing, the Globals are either going to be picked or banned, generally speaking. Maybe Murky. We don't see him nearly as much in Chair League as all of us are seeing in Hero League. Murky's a little bit easier to counter when you're on comms with the other members of your team. He's just not quite as much of a pain in the butt. Whereas in solo Hero League, he can really be a force of chaos that disrupts his opponents and be highly, highly annoying to deal with. However, we do have three Murky portraits on the side of Giant Killer, so maybe, just maybe, we'll have a Murky side in this game. All right, we do have 10 players divided into two teams. Both teams have selected their drafter. And as soon as one last player gets back from the little boys or little girls restroom, I will hit the start game button. I have casted, I believe, Giant Killer in the past, but I don't think I've casted Lion Speed, and I am always excited to cast a new team and get to know new people. Excuse Excuse me. All right, we are officially hitting the start button, and game two of our Chair League doubleheader has officially begun. Division two between Lion Speed and Giant Killer, both teams undefeated at 3-0, and in about 20 minutes we will have one undefeated team left at 4-0, and one of these teams will be at 3-1. It looks like Lion Speed saw all of those murky portraits and responded appropriately by banning out the annoying, frustrating, whirling dervish of annoyance that is Murky. And they wasted no time in doing it either. Giant Killer, now thinking about their first ban of this evening, would not be surprised to see a Dahaka ban, Artanis sometimes ban, Ragnaros, of course, you see him all over the place right now. Very highly prioritized and high-level competitive play, and no difference here in Chair League. Falstad, possibly, on Sky Temple, where his mobility is even more valuable than on some other maps. Whatever their decision is, we will know it in 7 seconds or less. And they opt to ban Zarya, currently with the shield meta that we are in. They want no part of the Russian powerhouse. Lion Speed here knows exactly what they want and insta-locks the Dahaka. He is in a great spot right now. Don't usually see him solo tanking, so I would be surprised if we didn't see a second warrior selected for Lion Speed at some point in this draft. Giant Killer now has two selections to make, and there are many solid choices on the board. The Varian Ragnaros combo is out there for the stun, taunt, sulfurous smash setup. Gul'dan's still out there. Falstad. There's a lot of viable heroes in the game right now. I actually think the meta, other than Murky and Solo League, is actually in a pretty good spot. And Falstad, Artanis. Artanis can be really aggravating. If you land those swaps and pick off a member of the opposition, you can really turn a fight quickly. You can make it a 5-on-4 before the fight has even started. Ever since they made that switch to Artanis, he has been toward the top of the win rates. The dash and the swap, you can really do it from far away. There's the second tank that I said we would see from Lion Speed. The Master Skin Varian. Varian's Master Skin is one of my very favorites. Love to see that. I would imagine it's going to be a taunt variant, but you never know. We could see a Colossus Smash or Gasp, even a Twin Blades of Fury. Those would be surprising. Prisoner Tychus is the third selection for Lion Speed, and now we roll into the mid-draft ban for Giant Killer. I would be surprised if they didn't try to choke out a support of some sort, although they have not selected one themselves. Maybe it's Tassadar, because they banned Zarya. They don't want to deal with the shields. Could do that. Varian, something we didn't talk about, recently had his level 13 and level 16 talent selection switched. And that means Shieldbreaker, Shattering Throw, comes at 13 now. And that is particularly potent against Artanis. If you can use that Shattering Throw on Artanis, it really puts a damper on what he tries to do. So that's something to keep an eye on as we get past level 10 as well. Giant Killer does go with the support choke that I recommended, banning out Malfurion. Lion Speed, maybe they go with a support ban themselves, or possibly another warrior ban. Artanis, similar to Dahaka in that you don't usually see them as solo warriors, so I would be surprised if Giant Killer does not get a second warrior as well. Maybe they ban out the Brightwing here to keep Giant Killer from getting too many globals on the other side. Instead, they opt to go for the Rhaegar. So I would be surprised now if we didn't see a Lucio here. He's pretty prominent right now. Very solid hero. The speed utility gives an aspect to this game that we hadn't really seen before in quite the same way, because he empowers the whole team. And something I've seen him do that he excels at is when you have these 5-on-5 team fights, he enables his team to either disengage quickly and safely if things are going wrong, or if the opposition team is trying to break and flee from combat, that speed boost can allow you to pursue your enemy to a really devastating effect, and that speed or the slow from reverse amp can turn a minor team fight victory into a major one. So possibly see Lucio here. Could also see a Morales with the medevac. Instead, we see Giant Killer go with their second tank, Diablo, and a second global in Brightwing. So two durable, beefy frontliners in the form of Diablo and Artanis, and two global ranged heroes, a support in the form of Brightwing, and damage in the form of Falstad. Lion Speed's certainly going to select their support here. My guess is it's going to be a Morales or a Lucio. Although you do see a Karazim from time to time if they want to go that route. Certainly a possibility. And then another ranged assassin would be my guess to round out their composition. There's the Karazim on the best skin he has in the game, and there is Vala, one of the top assassins. So Karazim sometimes struggles to solo heal. It'll be interesting to see if they go seven-sided strike or divine palm. Giant Killer now has to choose their last hero. They could really do any number of things. If they don't want to solo support Brightwing, they could pick a second support, although that would leave them a little bit light on damage. I don't think you want Falstad to be your only damage dealer. So we're going to see some kind of ranged DPS, I would guess. All of the mages are really on the board right now. Jaina, Kael'thas, Gul'dan, and Li Ming, all of which would be nice selections. You do have Raynor out there if you wanted that steady Eddie auto attack damage that he provides. If you want to go something a little different, Taz Dingo is still on the board, or Zul Jin. I tend to call him Taz Dingo. Zul Jin on the board if they wanted to go that route. Let's see what Giant Killer is going to do. They go with the Jaina. So going with the mages, the Apoc Ring of Frost combo is really good. This is absolutely live. You guys have about a 2-minute delay, so it's 2 minutes live. So here we go, best of one between Lion Speed and Giant Killer for the rights to sit at the top of Chair League's Division 2. And we are officially loading into Sky Temple. Representing Lion Speed, wearing the blue trunks for this game, Big Wiz on Dahaka, Patches on Vala, Varchese on Tychus, S-Fox on Varian. I assume that's supposed to be Star Fox 64. They're a throwback for the people of my generation. And Glaucus on Karazim. Wearing the red trunks and the white trim, Giant Killer, Velcro playing Diablo, Cheyenne on Falstad, Marika on Artanis, Zero on Brightwing, and Weak Sauce on Jaina. Typically, you see both teams run to the mid lane where they throw some jabs at each other, feel each other out. Maybe you get the first blood of the game, but that's pretty unusual. Typically, the teams run out there, they throw some spells at each other, they smack each other with their hammers and their swords, and then everybody runs back to lane. The X factor in that, though, is Artanis. If Artanis lands a good swap and the follow-up from Diablo and the poly is there, you never know. Maybe they pick off an unsuspecting Vala or a Tychus. Here we go. Both teams are present. Nobody wants to fight over the vision. Instead, they want to skirmish for these bushes in the middle of the mid lane. Both teams dancing. No one has vision on anybody else, but they are being very careful. And there, Patches scouts out Diablo with her Q. And it looks like Lion Speed doesn't want any part of this quite yet. Varian is very weak early game. Dehaka has burrowed to the top. Falstad has flown to the bottom. And nobody else has responded from their corresponding teams. Nope, Dehaka now burrowed to the bottom. So Dehaka and Falstad will square off in the bottom lane. Looks like Jaina and Karazim will square off in the mid lane. I'm sorry, in the top lane. There's the swap onto Varian. And Diablo body slamming him, isolating him. It looks like he will get away, although he is going to feel that in the morning. In my headset, guys, it feels like the game volume is a little loud relative to my voice, so please let me know if the game volume is too loud. So here at 1 minute and 20 seconds, the mid temple and the top temple will spawn, and the first major strategic decision of the team shot callers has to be made. Do we leave somebody in the bottom lane, or do we call everybody up to the temples? In the early going, Lion Speed has secured both temples. This is the last game of me for this evening. Diablo isolating out Varian once again. Vala and Varian forced to withdraw. And Giant Killer pushes Lion Speed out. Jaina going a little too far forward, though, and taking 100 fists to the face from Karazin for her troubles. Both teams have opted to abandon the bottom lane and not try to set up that second temple phase. Giant Killer will secure the mid temple. Lion Speed will secure the top temple. And we'll see which team comes out. Both teams are not soaking all of the lanes. Only two. Magic subsides. Find However, the experience about dead even. The next temple will spawn in the bottom lane. Whichever team manages these mercs will really give themselves an advantage when that happens. If you can time the top bruisers just right, you can get a lot of pressure in the opposing lane. And this might be a little bit of an advantage. An aggressive invasion, the charge in by Diablo and the swap, both members converging. And it will be a 4-on-4, but Diablo is the first blood of the game. The aggressive invasion does not pay off for Giant Killer. They lose the Giants and the Lord of Terror. And first blood secured for Lion Speed. A little bit of a lull now. I imagine you're going to see both of these teams start to rotate to the camps. Those Giants, however, are going to get value as only Falstad is here to defend and he cannot stand in against Vala and Tychus. Luckily, Artanis has arrived to provide reinforcements and they will try to clear out the Siege Giants. In the meantime, Lion Speed, knowing full well how important these top mercs are, has sent Dehaka and Karazin to secure them. Giant Killer, though, one game volume a little too loud, one game volume a little too quiet. I think that means I'm going to leave it right where it is. So Giant Killer will have some decisions to make. The mercs are pushing in the top lane for Lion Speed, and there will be no corresponding pressure coming from Giant Killer. So they have to decide whether they want to contest the fort in its entirety or clear out top lane. They will not be able to do both. Really, I think the way to do that was leave Falstad in top. If you're going to leave somebody there, then he can fly. Instead, Jaina is trying to deal with Dehaka and the push. So at least it will be a 4-on-4 if Brightwing ports in. And there's the teleport from Brightwing. And a great swap onto Vala. Hatch is isolated in the back line, taking a lot of damage. Karazin dove in there to heal her, but unable to keep her up. Artanis also very low. He goes as well. So a 1-for-1 trade. Jaina, though, was in the top lane clearing. Dehaka burrowed down. So Giant Killer will be at the disadvantage until Jaina arrives. That was a great swap on the Vala. However, he was also exposed on the other side. Varian isolated out by Diablo. Fox taking a lot of damage, as is Falstad, and Falstad is the first one to go. Jaina arrives to drop a Blizzard, and everybody is so low except for Jaina, who just arrives. Lionspeed gets the advantage in that team fight, though, however, securing three kills and forcing Giant Killer to abandon this temple. They have now have about a one-level advantage, and they will most certainly reach their heroic before Giant Killer does. Giant Killer responded by sending all of their members into lane to maximize as much soak as possible. And heroics have been achieved for Lionspeed. We have Adaptation for Dahaka, Commandeer Odin for Tychus, Taunt for Varian, Divine Palm for Karazim, and Vala is being a little bit cheeky and not showing. There she goes. She's going Reign of Vengeance. So you have Taunt, Reign of Vengeance, and the drag on Dahaka to really isolate out one of the targets from Giant Killer. They really need to be aware of their positioning to make sure they don't get caught. Jaina, oh, she is right in there, just misses on the Reign of Vengeance. You could tell Varian had violence in his eyes, really wanted to catch that Jaina out of position. She was able to back up just enough. Zero does teleport in as Brightwing to help defend this bottom lane. And there's the taunt, the stun, the APOC, everything goes out. Brightwing is absolutely obliterated. And the bottom fort for Giant Killer falls as well. Heroics achieved just before that engagement for Giant Killer. We have Apocalypse on Diablo, Mighty Gust on Falstad, Suppression Pulse for Artanis, Link Heal from Brightwing, and Ring of Frost from Vala. Diablo caught too far forward. The stun lock from Lionspeed, I should say, is absolutely real, and they were able to secure a pick onto Diablo. Falstad must smell something is coming. He is backing up. No, he doesn't. There's the Dahaka. I think she's too far away for the drag, and he is. Falstad getting away just in the nick of time before Varian arrives. I think it is too loud. Okay, now I have two people telling me game volume is too loud. We will turn it down a little bit. That should be a little better, guys. Let me know. So top temple currently in possession of Lionspeed. Bottom temple secured by Giant Killer, and now they get on the point. So it looks like team's contented to split. And that's what they will do. A 4-on-4 engagement. No, 5-on-4, because the Haka has showed up. There's the Ring of Frost. Captures 3. Brightwing, however, does go down. It wasn't enough to secure any kills for Giant Killer. Those red health bars are getting very low. APOC used defensively does capture 4, but Diablo falls anyway. Commandeer Odin popped, doing damage to the backline. Giant Killer absolutely has to retreat, and they will maybe rotate to the top temple and try to get as much value as possible. And that's exactly what they're going to do. Giant Killer retreating to the top lane. They will attempt to secure, I assume, this top temple. And there they go. Now, the danger here for Giant Killer is the boss is available. And I think Lionspeed could secure it if they chose to. However, instead, they're going to opt to take this talent tier advantage, 2-level advantage. And they want to come up here and put pressure onto Giant Killer, and they do. Diablo is caught in that stun lock. Falstad using the gust to keep himself and Brightwing and Jaina alive, and they retreat so they are not caught in the flank. Artanis, however, I don't think will have that luxury. Caught by 5 members of Lionspeed. 2 more deaths for Giant Killer. And Giant Killer here in a very rough spot. Lionspeed controlling this game for sure. And up almost 2 full levels. They will rotate down and take this mid fort for free. So all of the forts for Giant Killer have now been destroyed. Only one lost by Lion Speed, and it looks like they may rotate to the boss now. I was going to say, that would have been a very aggressive call here with all five members on both teams up. They instead will secure the Siege Giants here. Some indecision on the part of Giant Killer. I don't think they quite know where they want to go. They are going to get this top Bruiser camp now that it has spawned and try to soak as much as they possibly can to even out the levels. This is the time for Giant Killer to fight, should they choose, before Lion Speed gets to 16. Once Lion Speed secures 16, they do not want to fight down talent tiers. Instead, they opt to go secure their own Siege Giants as well and equalize the pressure on the bottom lane. Both teams have checked boss, posturing around boss. Giant Killer is altogether as 5. Lion Speed, in the meantime, has the Haka constantly putting pressure into another lane. They know he can just burrow in whenever they need him. And we do have an ambush set up here. Artanis is caught in it. Ring of Frost does catch Varian, who is then body slammed by Diablo. However, Divine Palm, perfectly timed, keeps Varian going. A lot of damage going out, but no death secured so far. Varian has less than 100 health, and he's able to get away safely. A great engagement by both sides. Both sides retreating with low health pools. So now there's a decision to be made. Level 16 has been achieved by Lion Speed. Does Giant Killer want to contest this top keep? Down a talent tier. Aggressive call here for Lion Speed. They are taking the boss with their 16 advantage. I don't think Giant Killer has any idea that they're doing it, and it could spell disaster. The boss will be secured for Lion Speed, and as the Giant Killer is forced to respond, they will most definitely get most of this top temple as well. Decisions to be made for Giant Killer. Do they withdraw and defend the boss, or do they fight level 16 to level 15? They are not here yet. Falstad too far forward. Charged, taunted, blizzard, and down he goes. There's another big Ring of Frost. The follow-up just isn't there. Jaina has been hitting some pretty good rings. They just haven't been able to secure kills. Falstad and Jaina, they both go down. This game currently being controlled by Lion Speed. The remnants of Giant Killer will go to this bottom lane and try to take out this boss. Lion Speed securing the temple and putting pressure on the mid-keep wall, showing absolutely no pressure. Apoc used to just try to keep them away, relieve some of the pressure being put on by Lion Speed. Really not much accomplished there, though. Almost a nice swap that would have definitely led to a pick on the part of Tychus. The good news for Giant Killer is, despite all of that, they haven't lost a keep yet. Diablo once again charged, taunted, he's got in there. Still hasn't gone down yet. There he finally goes, Diablo. However, he does have souls. He will be back. Falstad running for her life, as is Brightwing. Commandeer Odin was popped. And the swap missed one more time. Lion Speed looks contented to control the map. Get the mercs. And so they shall. Giant Killer in defense mode right now, doing everything they can to keep pressure off of their keeps. Control the lanes. However, the vision really in Lion Speed's favor. This is the moment for Giant Killer, though. This is when they want to pick a fight. They want to pick it before Lion Speed gets to 20 on even talent tiers. Never a good situation to fight down 3 levels, but this is going to be the best fight they get before level 20. If they don't take it here, they almost have to wait until level 20. Little bit of indecision on the part of Giant Killer. Doesn't quite look like they know where they want to go. They have shown up to the bottom lane to clear out these Siege Giants. Lion speed, still nobody imposturing towards either one of these temples. They have appeared in the top lanes and the bottom lanes. Looks like Lion speed will go top and Giant Killer will go bottom. With the structural lead, Lion speed can of course choose to simply trade these temples and no harm done. So that's what the teams will do. They will once again trade the temples. Lion Speed secures the top. Giant Killer secures the bottom. Lion Speed, now that they're showing in the bottom, Lion Speed makes a good call here, aggressively taking the bruisers on the red side of the map. Red is responding, though. They're going to be too late to do anything about it. And this top keep of Giant Killer is no longer there. So one keep down, bottom keep for Giant Killer is very low as well. And level 20 talent reached for Lion Speed. We have Big Red Button for Tychus, Apex Predator for Dahaka, Farflex Quiver for Vala, Glory to the Alliance for Varian, and Storm Shield for Karazim. There is a lot of blue on this map, not nearly as much red. Giant Killer is going to have to bide some time till hopefully they can reach 20 as well and maybe get an even team fight or something close to even anyway. Lion Speed showing a lot of patience. They're certainly moving around the map, playing the map, not willing to take any dangerous team fights as they feel like the game is theirs to lose, and it most certainly is right now. Since Giant Killer showed on the top, Lion Speed on the bottom is going to do what they can to take this bottom keep. It is very low. It wouldn't take much. Giant Killer has to respond. Does they get the swap? No, the swap just missed on the Vala. There's the aggressive flying from Falstad. The gust, the ring of frost, aggressive initiation from Giant Killer. And they are able to secure the first kill of the fight on Vala. For the first time this game, Lion Speed is on the retreat. Giant Killer on the attack, but a turn onto Jaina with the taunt and the big red button. Commandeer Odom is doing a ton of damage. Falstad goes down, Jaina goes down, and just as quickly as that looked like everything was going great for Giant Killer, the turn was made by Lion Speed. Brightwing, the only member alive, and it looks like they will try to make the boss call. May as well take out this keep, it's so low. Brightwing does finally fall. The core call made by Lion Speed. No minions here to tank the core. I don't think it's going to matter, though. Hit points are getting a little low, though. Let's see how it rolls. Yeah, this is most certainly going to be the end of this game. Lion Speed controlling, for the most part, this game from cover to cover. They increased their record on Season 4 in Division 2. Lion Speed now 4-0. And at the top of Division 2, Giant Killer still having a great season, of course, at 3-1, most certainly in the discussion and in the race for the Division 2 playoffs. So congratulations to Lion Speed for taking that game and securing their victory. Thank you for both teams for allowing me to cast your game, and those of you who are in the chat for hanging out. We'll be back for more Chair League next week. Keep an eye on my Twitch channel. I do post my schedule up there over the weekend as I get games casted. Everybody have a wonderful evening, and we'll see you in the Nexus. Good night, all.